Unified School District Number 1. Notice of this regular meeting will be given to the public by forwarding the complete agenda to all requesting radio stations and newspapers. Copies of the complete agenda are available for inspection at all public schools and at the superintendent's office. Anyone desiring information as to forthcoming meetings should contact the superintendent's office. Would you all join me and stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which we stand, one nation, under God, indivisible, for liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Jessica, roll call, please.
Ms. Stevens?
Here.
Mr. Garcia?
Present.
Mr. Battle?
Here.
Mr. Duncan?
Present.
Mr. Koenig?
Here.
Mrs. Motter? Mr. Wade?
Present. Awards and recognition. Dr. Sue.
Thank you, Mr. President. We have several this evening. I'll call up Tanya Reuter to start us off. As she's behind the door somewhere. You want to, Tanya? We're ready. We're ready. And that's all right. Thank you.
Okay, sorry about that. Tonight we are celebrating not one, but multiple spelling bee titles Hannah has earned this year. After winning the KUSD Spelling Bee, Hannah moved on to the CESA 1 Regional Spelling Bee, where she placed second and qualified to move on to the Badger State Spelling Bee. There she tied for first and qualified for the Scripps National Spelling Bee, which took place in late May. It was here that she prevailed in the first and second spoken round and the first written round. She was one of 519 spellers who competed at the national level, and we are extremely proud of her for her wins along the way. This is a tough competition, and she put Kenosha on the map and made KUSD proud as she represented us on the national level. We commend you for your hard work and dedication, Hannah. Congratulations. I'd like to invite our district-wide student art show winner to the floor. Each year, the district hosts a student art show in conjunction with the Kenosha Museum that showcases the broad talents of our students across all grade levels. During the event, collection awards are given to students by the KUSD Board President, KUSD Fine Arts Coordinator, Kenosha Area Business Alliance, Kenosha Mayor, and KUSD Superintendent. This year, with us tonight, we have J.C. Zemenchik of Indian Trail for her Welcome to the Jungle picture. Our other awards, the students aren't with us tonight, include the Board of Education, Stephanie Perez of Bullen Middle School for Line Design, City of Kenosha, Paige Christensen of Bullen Middle School for Line Design, Kaba Joseph States of Tremper for Calling Me Home to You, Superintendent Soyan Kang of Indian Trail for Seaside. These beyond amazing works of art are on display at the back of the room, and we encourage you to stop by and take a look there back under the lights and admire them before you leave tonight. To our students, your talents are astounding, and we congratulate you on your achievements. Lastly, I'd like to invite our Music in the Parks winners to the floor. This group of Lance Middle School band, choir, and orchestra students before us all performed at the Music in the Parks competition in Sandusky, Ohio, where each group earned a superior first place rating, with choir and band also winning best overall in their categories. The students also earned the esprit de corps for the way they conducted themselves throughout the competition. We are so very proud of all of your awards and for the way you represented KUSD in such a professional manner while you were attending the competition. We are extremely proud of all of you. Thank you.
Okay, we have administrative and supervisory appointments.
We have none this evening, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sue. We do not have a student ambassador this week because of the summer vacation. Legislative report, Mrs. Motter is also on vacation. Views and comments by the public. Welcome to all of those who have signed up to speak to the board tonight. We would like to remind you that school board meetings are for the purpose of carrying on the business of the district. They are not public meetings, but official business meetings held in public. Through school board policy and rule 8870 titled Public Participation at Board Meetings, the board allows citizens an opportunity to make comments during the views and comments by the public portion of regular school board meetings. Speakers are limited to speak for up to 3 minutes, only once during a board meeting. Speakers shall not make irrelevant, repetitive, abusive, or harassing speech, speech that causes disruption to the orderly conduct of the meeting, discussion of confidential personal disputes, or grievances involving individual school employees that do not implicate issues of public concern, or individual student disciplinary matters, as there are channels available in the district, such as Board Policies 1720, 4270, 4271, and 5110 that provide for consideration and disposition of such matters. Pursuant to Wisconsin's open meetings law, generally speaking, the board members will not respond to the comments tonight, especially if the comments concern a topic that is not on the published agenda notice. Instead, your concern will be forwarded to the appropriate staff and may be addressed at a future board meeting. As you approach the microphone, please state your name. Thank you to each of tonight's speakers. As a reminder, this portion of our meeting will conclude after 45 minutes, according to policy. Board Secretary Jessica will keep the time. We will begin. Mr. Michael Thompson, followed by Dave DeBerg.
Thank you. President Wade and members of the Kenosha Unified Board of Education, my name is Dr. Michael B. Thompson, a retired podiatrist and resident of the district. Recently, I contacted board member Rebecca Stevens with a proposal. This idea originated with two highly regarded retired district administrators who asked me to carry the ball for them and whom I'll identify at the conclusion. The proposal is that the Reuther High School Auditorium be renamed the Ralph J. Houghton Auditorium, or something similar, as a memorial to Mr. Houghton, who developed the district music program into one of the finest in the nation. The program has maintained its reputation under his successors, as witnessed by its recent selection as one of the best music programs in Wisconsin. Through Mr. Houghton's leadership and guidance, we have seen KUSD graduates go on to careers as professional musicians, including two of which I'm aware who have been in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, considered perhaps the finest orchestra in the world. We also have many who entertain locally, either for their own financial reward or purely for the enjoyment of it. Furthermore, innumerable graduates have gone on to lives in which the enjoyment of music has played an integral part because of their initial exposure in school. Finally, the auditorium itself is both acoustically excellent and aesthetically beautiful, a magnificent creation of Chicago architect John D. Chubb. To recognize Ralph Houghton's contribution to Kenosha in this way elevates both his memory and the significance of the structure itself. It also spotlights the KUSD music program, of which we are all justly proud. So who are the two people responsible for this idea? Dr. John J. Hosmanic, superintendent of the district during the 1980s, and Mr. Robert L. Loss, who was in charge of all non-instructional areas of the district during the Hosmanic years. Finally, we should note that Mr. Houghton served as assistant superintendent during that time, too. I urge the board to consider their proposal, whether through appointment of an ad hoc committee or other means, so that the contributions of Ralph Houghton can be properly recognized. Thank you for your attention and consideration of this request.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Dave DeBerg, followed by Mr. John Anderson.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. David T. DeBerg. I worked with the district for 15 years, and what I passed out for those that can't see was an article in the Kenosha News, and when I read it, I thought, I feel that way in various areas, and I just want to read this May 23rd, 2018 article, which was written by the editorial staff, the Kenosha News. Just a few sentences I want to read, and the heart of what I want to say is about the security in our district, specifically the elementary schools. Now, as a former Wisconsin Army National Guard soldier, and I've been in many foreign countries, including Israel, when you travel in Israel, every time you see a group of kids, especially young kids, there's always someone there. And they are trained, and they are trained to engage an active shooter. Now, in this article, it says the only immediate and effective measurement that stops an active shooter is a well-trained and armed security officer. I really want you all to think about that. When I go to pick up my daughter out at Summers, there's a lot of people. I don't know about you, but when I am in a larger group of people, I scan the crowd, and as a citizen, I'm aware because in a moment it can happen, and if you don't have someone there trained, 3 to 5 minutes is your response time from police. And by the time the police or Kenosha County sheriffs get there, it's all over. So I really want you to consider that. In Florida, the Polk County School Board voted to develop a new school safety program that involves hiring 85 armed school safety guardians who will protect elementary students throughout the district. And as I share this, think about all of the elementary schools. I've been in them all, and I love kids. And our kids are worth more than just electronic devices and scanners and cameras. And I want to just say that one, the one thought again, of needing someone trained professionally and armed to engage an active shooter. Just a few more things. This is a great program and a good way to add another level of safety and security to our school campuses. It's a model for other schools. So you can do your due diligence, school board, and consider what would be best and that there would be more done in our district for security, especially the elementary schools. And finally, I urge the school board to take immediate steps and actions to look at this plan, mitigate the threat at our schools in the short term while planning additional layers of security. I know you all care, and I see Gary sometimes at the Quick Trip, and I've tried to establish a personal relationship.
I'm sorry, but your time is up.
Time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. DeBerg. Mr. John Anderson.
Good evening, President Wade and board members, and thank you for letting me share a couple words tonight. As stated, my name is John Anderson. I am a former music teacher in the Kenosha Unified School District and the grandson of one grandson of Ralph Houghton. And I came in support of Dr. Thompson tonight and many others in town who had reached out to me and told me that this was going to be brought up this evening. Dr. Wells, who was supposed to be here this evening, is no longer able to attend and had asked me to read something. And so I'm going to read that with my time. In support of Dr. Thompson's proposal that we rename Reuther Auditorium the Ralph J. Houghton Memorial Auditorium or something similar, my family, the Houghton family, is behind that, and we support that. And Dr. Wells, who was a former coordinator of fine arts and teacher in our district, has this to say in support of that. Ralph Houghton put the Kenosha Unified School District on the map across the country by taking a fledgling music program and, through great leadership, made the music program one of the best in the country. His belief that a strong music program would not only benefit the children of Kenosha musically, but contribute positively to the students' overall academic success proved to be long before its time. Now research continues to substantiate what Mr. Houghton knew decades before. Students who participate in a strong choral and instrumental music program will also see gains in their academic performance. Mr. Houghton also knew how to find and hire the best music educators, knowing that if a candidate was weak, either as a musician or as a teacher, that they could learn to do better so that the child could get what they deserved. Mr. Houghton could inspire and motivate his staff, sometimes with a pat on the back, and other times, as he would say, with a kick in the seat. He had confidence in his hires and gave them all the support they needed. The naming of the auditorium at Reuther and Harborside would be a fitting tribute to a man that spent his life building the Kenosha Unified Music Program and giving as much of his time as he could to our students and children. And he wanted to add as well that various facilities have been named after beloved members of our community like Amici Field at Tremper and the Jasquith Stadium at Indian Trail. And I'll leave you with just a really silly, simple quote. My grandfather loved Reuther, the auditorium. He absolutely loved it and brought some great acts in there over the years. And he used to say that you could make a burp sound angelic in that place. And so that's my challenge to all of you. But I want to throw our family support behind Dr. Thompson's proposal. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. Is Dr. Wells here tonight? No, he's not. Okay. Kate Trudell.
I'm going to get rid of my gum. That's poor taste. All right.
Good evening. My name is Kate Trudell, and I live at 7850 34th Avenue. I'm here to discuss the enforcement of the dress code policy, new and old. Last Friday morning, I saw a concerning post on social media. A female summer gym student was approached by a Tremper gym teacher regarding her gym attire. Her gym attire, which I have pictured here and I'll show you later, looked very much like what I'm wearing here tonight. Gym shorts with a high neck sleeveless shirt. While the student's top is very technically against the current dress code policy because the sleeveless shirt does not meet the edge of her shoulder, it is within the new dress code parameters. That being said, considering the fact that an unair-conditioned Tremper gets very warm during the summer, this attire seemed entirely appropriate to the parent who picked it out for her daughter. That parent, whose social media posts I'll also share at the end of my speech with her permission, was and is very distressed about the fact that her daughter was reprimanded in front of her peers. She was not only embarrassed by the approach, but threatened with being sent home for the day if she violated the code again. When I shared this information with Dr. Sue last week, she was very quick to respond and promise an investigation. While it appears an investigation may have occurred, the parent meeting that took place yesterday included a member of administration who is related to the staff member accused of improperly handling the dress code violation in the first place. This appeared to be a conflict of interest to the parent and made her uncomfortable. Further, the student was never approached for comment before the meeting with the parent. I'm not entirely sure how you conduct an investigation without talking to the complainant and potential witnesses. Setting the investigation aside, I am troubled by this enforcement. While I'm happy that the board passed a new policy for the new year, half of the concern with the former policy was that the way it affected those accused of violating it. Our specific concerns were that students were being reprimanded in front of peers and were being taken from class or sent home for violations. When the dress code was discussed in open session, some board members advocated for creating dignified procedures for enforcing the new policy. The enforcement procedure was ultimately left to the administration. Unfortunately, there has been no procedure set yet. I'm here tonight to ask the board to require the following from administration as they propose enforcement of this policy. Number one, mandate district-wide training on the enforcement of the new dress code as soon as possible. Number two, release written guidelines to all KUSD schools prohibiting school officials from enforcing the dress code in a discriminatory manner during the school year and summer school, which includes prohibiting the public humiliation and degradation of students through practices such as measuring their skirt and strap lengths or otherwise addressing the dress code violation in front of their peers. These guidelines should also prohibit school officials from threatening heightened sanctions against students who engage in lawful acts of protest. Number three, distribute written notice to all KUSD parents and students informing them that the dress code enforcement guidelines have been distributed and all educators and school officials have undergone proper training. This notice should also outline the new policy, its proper enforcement, and the rightful punishment for its violation. Thank you for your time.
And I'd like to call Chris, is that Strauss?
Good evening, everyone. I am Chris Strauss, and I am here in support of Kate. In Brown versus Board of Education, psychologists Kenneth and Mamie Clark demonstrated that segregation harmed Black children's self-images. Their testimony before the Supreme Court contributed to the landmark Supreme Court case that desegregated American public schools. Self-image is important as we speak of dress code again today. Self-image, the mental representation one creates of themselves. It is subject to all kinds of distortion, including teachers, and it is the driving force in eating disorders, depression and anxiety, and other behavioral and emotional challenges. Parents want schools to teach, to nurture, and to protect their children both physically and psychologically. What this district has provided doesn't accomplish that yet. Adult teachers harassing minor children about their exposed shoulders or long distracting legs does cause psychological scarring. The teachers don't see it. They are not the ones who are holding their strong child who is bawling in their arms. The teachers think it passes, but it doesn't. The child's confidence plummets for years, not days. We need that confidence in our children because that confidence drives engagement, and engagement drives learning. The dress code issues parents are upset over does segregate and does cause our children to develop an inferiority complex and self-hatred. And unlike other issues, this one isn't difficult to correct. Thanks.
And Ms. Angie Aker.
My name is Angie Aker. I'm at 3128 Roosevelt Road, and I will be here more often now that my job situation has changed, so hold your applause. But I'm here to support Kate as well. And of course, I'm very, very pleased in what was accomplished in this last year with the dress code. I think it's a great step in the right direction. I think enforcement and how that happens and how that training goes is also the second piece of that that's super important. And So I want to read the post that was on social media from the parent whose daughter had this issue the other day. Beyond annoyed, my daughter has summer gym at Tremper. It gets extremely hot in there. They have no AC and they really work them during the hours they're there. Why is it that the new dress code they implemented doesn't pertain to summer? It really makes no sense. A gym teacher at Tremper, who is not my daughter's teacher, has harassed her and called her out about her shirt for the last 2 days, threatening to send her home if it happens again. She has embarrassed her in front of her peers as well. Please tell me how this is okay. I just don't understand. The shirt she wore is within the new dress code that starts at the beginning of this upcoming school year. And so clearly there's some frustration because this new dress code hasn't started yet, and there's some, you know, there's, as we implement it, there's going to be some rough patches. But why I think this is super important to talk about is the relationship between teachers and students. I think that what happens when we have teachers policing this, and especially pulling students out in front of other classmates and talking to them about this in front of other classmates is it fundamentally changes the relationship between the teacher and the student. It takes away that rapport, that mutual rapport that students and teachers have, that symbiosis, and it replaces it with this feeling of being surveilled or that, you know, this person is there to sort of police their attire, especially for minor infractions like this, which you'll see in the photo that Kate gives you. But I think that this is so important to think about because we don't have data on all the reasons that add up that lead to dropout rates, right? We have our best guesses at what leads to dropout rates. But there are little things that don't get measured because we're not tracking it that causes students to pull away and to disengage and to fracture those relationships with the staff and with their teachers. And I think this is one where it's not a battle that we really have to fight. We can do this in, you know, I just think more wise ways by having one-on-one conversations with the students and by not nitpicking if something is pretty close to the dress code. I think that fundamentally we just really need to change our philosophy about enforcing the dress code and make sure we're consistent with the training across the board. Thank you.
Thank you to all the speakers this evening. Comments by the board? Any lights? Mrs. Stevens.
Thank you. I'd like to take a moment just to thank all the speakers tonight. Thank you, Dr. Thompson, for coming forward and bringing such a wonderful opportunity forward for our district to honor Ralph Houghton. And I really appreciate your patience in this matter, so thank you for coming. As far as the dress code goes, I just want to touch lightly on that. We do have some information coming out that was sent to us via the administrators, so we are looking at how that's going to roll out. And I agree with you, we need to make sure there are a few key items. We don't want to shame anyone. We don't want to demean anyone in front of their peers. We want to make sure that there's proper training and communication surrounding this. Because it can be very intimidating and uncomfortable. And when you're going to school, you're there to learn, and you want to be respected. So I think it's super important to make sure that we communicate well on this. And this is the photo, and I did get a copy of it from Kate earlier, too. So I see where it's very confusing for me as a board member, too. So I definitely think we need to do a better job with addressing this. And I remember my gym suit didn't look that far off of this, and that was a long time ago in high school. So I really am confused with this myself. So I know Dr. Sue's addressing it, and we will get that information out. But I really think it's a good idea to have a form that we sign off on once the training is complete, and also have a form that the parents and the students, so they understand it. So we've got something on record saying, yeah, I do understand this, and I have receive the training, and that the students and the parents understand what's expected of, and communication is so key to that. So thank you for speaking to that. I just wanted to also say thank you to everyone for such an amazing school year. We've made some real progress and hit some milestones over this past year. And I look forward to the coming year, and before you know it, it will be here, and we will be in the thick of things again. Not that we ever get the time off in the summer anyway. I have a lot of big ticket items coming up for the board, so I appreciate all everyone in this district does to build a strong district for our students and our staff. So thank you again, speakers. Have a good night.
Any other board members? No. All right, remarks by the president, that's me. Two things I just want to address briefly. A week ago, I was at a retirees dinner for all the retired staff at KUSD over the last year. I just want to take this opportunity on behalf of the board to thank all those, whether it be teachers, supervisors, janitors, whatever the case may be. Thank you for your years of dedicated service, not only to the schools, but primarily to all the students. Some 20 plus thousand students, in one way, shape, or form, I think that each retiree has made a positive impression on student and students. And that's a great thing. I hope if they have the opportunity to run into one of the students in the future, if they don't come up to you and you recognize them, introduce yourself. I think that'll make a world of difference to them. What you've done for this district and for our students is truly remarkable, and we truly appreciate it. In regards to the dress code, the staff, the board, and a lot of people put a lot of hard work into the new dress code. I think it's a little more liberal than some wanted and not restrictive enough as some others liked, but I think it was a good compromise. Now, along with the new dress code, we're also going to be rolling out how to enforce it. And that's the important thing, how to enforce it. And consistency. Now, as us old people like to say, back in the day, we didn't have dress codes when I went to school, at least not that I'm aware of anyways. You were expected to go to school dressed appropriately, whatever that may have been back then. We didn't have much of a style show like we do nowadays. But I think a little common sense prevailed, and I would hope in the future common sense does prevail. I think it's a good dress code. Could it be better? Of course it could. And I hope someday that we don't need a dress code. But we do have a dress code. We will be rolling it out. And each student, parent, staff will be notified of it, and the staff will be instructed on how to enforce it, what to do and what not to do. Common sense would dictate that you don't call anybody out on the carpet for anything in front of someone else. I mean, that's common sense. And I think as a board, you know, we agree on that, and we will make sure that that is carried out in the coming years. Thank you. Superintendent's report. Dr. Sue, enlighten us.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. President, members of the board. I think, Rebecca, you summed it up that it just doesn't stop. So I'd like to share some of those highlights. Again, many thanks to the board members that attended our graduations, because it's really extreme pride that I have, and I know that all of you have, for our 1,500 graduates who crossed the stage at the end of May and early June. That's applaudable. We had so much to celebrate as these young men and women for the years have worked hard in their dedication to their academic future careers. Many of them truly have big plans. I think some of you sat there and had a chance to talk to a few of them. As they prepare either to enter college or workforce, they spent years of studying, they've grown socially, emotionally, and it's my pleasure always to see. Today I was at elementary school. It's always a pleasure to see, you know, a 5- and 6-year-old, and all of a sudden you see these graduates and really hear them being articulate and where they're heading. So congratulations to all our graduates and all the staff that has guided them along their journey. Not you know, as well, all of our graduates go on to college, but for the KUSD graduates who are, this is astounding. Many will have scholarships supporting their next chapter in life. In fact, KUSD graduates earned a whopping total of more than $26.5 million in scholarships. That is a sigh of relief, I think, to many parents and educators who often worry about the cost of college and those pursuing that higher education. So that's a kudos again to our students who have to fill out all those applications for scholarships and have received them. These funds earned for our students for their academic and even athletic excellence have proven nothing can stop them from reaching their goals and their top. So really, really, truly proud of all of our students. This leads me to thank our staff again, as you were sharing, our retired staff as well throughout the district, the educators who helped our graduates and students at all levels grow and learn throughout the year. The impact that the staff has made on our children, for our community, is outstanding, and we really, really are forever grateful. Whether it's, you know, those daily lessons, it could be a friendly conversation, it could be providing a snack, tending to an injury, or any of the multiple tuta things that happen during a school day, truly, truly thank you for all the dedication you have done. And lastly, as we all know, learning has not stopped for the year. We have summer school and summer camps in full swing with students engaged in projects. We're thrilled to have so many families taking advantage of these summer learning opportunities that will help our students achieve great success in the long run. not to mention our additional camps and offerings our community partners are offering to students. We have the free YMCA camps at Epsilon and Roosevelt, the Outreach Center Summer Camp at Brass Community School, and again, just really, really grateful for our community support and all that happens during the summer to keep the students engaged and doing some activities for learning. And finally, as I had shared a month ago, we really want to accent our middle schools, and very proud of Bullen Middle School. We'd like to share their video with you of how proud they are of their school. So we'll watch Bullen Middle School this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Sue. I was at one of the several.
Excuse me. I love Bowling because of just how we're made to feel when we're here. We're all in this together, and our students feel safe and supported here. I feel safe and supported here. We're a family.
We're one big family, and we rely on each other, and how, like, we're all different cultures and we do all different types of stuff, so we get to like teach each other.
I think one of the coolest things about Bowling and one of the things that I love most is that we have such a diverse population here, and it's really, really neat because it's a diverse population, but it represents the town we live in. It represents Kenosha, and I think that's really special.
Los maestros y los estudiantes me ayudan a prepararme para el futuro porque somos muy diversos y todos tenemos diferentes culturas, especialmente en el lenguaje dual, y puedo ver cómo ellos hacen cosas diferentes que mi familia. Entonces eso me puede abrir los ojos y yo sé, oh, pues no somos todos iguales, todos tenemos diferentes maneras.
The staff and the students were able to form relationships and have a family feel here because we are so invested. We are truly invested in our students and making a difference in their lives. When you meet the parent, you get a different feel. I really want to be a part of their lives and be that change agent and help them. So that's why we're able to truly build those relationships, because we're not afraid of that.
Teachers here just provide such a supportive, nurturing, welcoming classroom. And when kids feel nurtured and loved, I think that's when they can really open their minds to learn.
They prepare us to become leaders and like to have our own voice instead of like just following people.
They're helping me by like getting me prepared for college and everything, and they're showing me work that I'm going to need in the future.
I really love how they have like really nice people and people you can talk to, and if you need help, you can ask them.
I like that the teachers are involved in a lot of groups and help us, and that they do spirit weeks with us and participate in those things.
We have a lot of cool programs here at Bullen. One of my favorites is called TAC. Stands for Totally Awesome Choices, and every Friday our students have the opportunity to go to a club during school hours, and they can sign up for whatever they want, you name it, we got it, and kids can go there and explore opportunities that maybe they otherwise wouldn't have the chance to.
We have a lot of hands-on activities and a lot of groups that are really good, help you with your independence and hard work, and it's a good balance of education and fun.
We have opportunities to support students in all areas, no matter where they're coming from. We're able to really provide them with those individualized opportunities to help them reach their maximum success.
We also have a transition coach program where it's our current eighth graders that work with our incoming sixth graders, helping them transition into Bowling and help them throughout the year.
I believe that connections and relationships are key. Students are proud to be an alumni of a middle school, and they come back here and seek out teachers, staff members, because of those relationships that we built. It just helps them feel connected, and we feel a sense of belonging. We feel like we're at home.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sue, and I gotta apologize. With age comes a certain amount of hearing loss. My wife called it selective hearing, so I apologize for interrupting that wonderful video. The only thing I did wanna say is several of the board members and I had the opportunity to attend a lot of the graduations. If you didn't get a chance, I hope next year you do. It's absolutely been fantastic. I mean, that's a culmination of their first career, I guess, and it was really great. Let's move on to the consent agenda, please.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation for the consent agenda, please.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Ms. Reese's recommendation. Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? So moved. New business. Discussion action, reports of contracts in aggregate of $25,000. Dr. Sue.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the board, this recommendation is for the board to approve the purchase of an ACT Aspire interim assessments for the 2018-2019 school year. Questions definitely can be answered via Mr. Keckler. However, this is just, and again, in alignment to help our students, as they move forward to take the ACT in 11th grade, as now that's a state mandate for all 11th graders. So we would be switching over to this assessment to help them do that. So I don't know if anybody has any questions, but our recommendation is that we approve this $48,870 purchase, and that funding would come from the educational accountability funds.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation on the ACT and the change in the testing.
Thank you, Mrs. Stevens. A second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Garcia. Any discussion, questions of Mr. Keckler?
The only thing I would add is that since this was submitted, we have received confirmation that the state will be applying in the coming years additional accountability measures at the high school report cards that come out annually. Previously, they did not include student growth, but they will, and they will be using the ACT Aspire. So this will even be more applicable and aligned to those resources.
Thank you, Mr. Keckler. Any questions?
I'd just like to say thank you for taking care of this and for that alignment piece, and it makes so much sense. So thank you for addressing this.
Seeing no other lights, all those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? So moved. School year 2019-20 instructional calendar.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the board, it's hard to believe, but we are looking at the year 2019-2020, our instructional calendar. So our recommendation this evening is you take a look at it and you accept the proposed 2019-20 instructional calendar this evening. As you know, we've articulated as well, we've done surveys and we stick to basically what the majority of our community, our family and staff has shared with. If you have any questions, I know Mr. Keckler can entertain those questions as well.
Motion.
Move to approve.
Move
second.
To approve. Moved and seconded. Any discussion, questions? Seeing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. KUSD Policy Rule 6450, early credit.
Thank you. Again, you're going to have several policies coming forward. As we know, the state does make changes and rather quickly, and then they expect us to enact those changes quickly. So through Mr. Keckler's team here, we have done that. This one is the policy and rule 6450 regarding our early college credit program through Wisconsin Act 307. So really it's just to help align the new language with those conditions. And so we do recommend that the Board of Education review and approve the policy and rules 6450 early college graduate credit program. Revisions as a first reading this evening and then a second reading because it's a policy will come before you in July 24th.
Thank you.
Motion. I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation on the KUSD policy and rule 6470 student records and noting it's a first reading.
Moved and seconded. Any questions? Just one.
Sure.
Maybe I put you on the spot, but I doubt it. We never can. How many pre-college credits did we get from this last year? Do you have any idea?
Are you asking how many dual enrollment credit options were obtained by students? Quite a few. If you want something
specific,
that's
good. That's a good number.
It'll take a little
time.
Good. This, just to take really 30 seconds. The state sometimes moves really fast, and this program still hasn't even fully started next week, and it moves so fast that unfortunately the state did not consider all the conditions that may exist, and so this is already a corrective action already put out by the state, of which all the districts are expected to follow. If this wasn't there, the districts would be liable for additional funds well above and beyond any existing contracts that they may have with post-secondary. So we do have an enormous amount of dual credit options and look to expand those each year, but we also have to do it within the confines of what's applicable for both enrollment and agreements that might exist.
Thank you ever so much. Any other questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. KUSD policy 6470.
Again, Mr. President, members of the board, this is based on Wisconsin Act 251 to update language regarding the maintenance and confidentiality of student records. So we have done this in this board policy. We're expected to do that, as you know. So we do recommend this evening that you review and approve the policy and rule 6470, student records, as revision as a first read this evening. And again, it'll come back to you as a second read on July 24th. And again, if we have questions, Mr. Keckler is available.
Motion to approve.
It's
been moved and seconded. Any questions, discussion? Seeing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Keckler.
Yes, thank you. Discussion action policy rule 1210, communication school sponsored.
Yeah, it's a big title up front because it's like three policies. So as we do look at policies as part of the governance of the structure, we find occasionally that many are outdated, in particular this one since 2006. Through Tanya's department and over the years, communication office has changed. So she took a look at it and updated it. So if there's some clarifications or information, but we are recommending that you approve this one. Revised policy in rule 1210. Communication with parents, guardians, caretakers, including crisis, and eliminate administrative regulation, communication, school-sponsored crisis policy, and rule 1200, public relations program, and policy 1211, parent, guardian, caregiver information program as a first read, which will come back again as a second read on July 12th. But any other questions? Ms. Reuter's up here as well.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation, and I'm not going to read that whole thing, but I'm going to start with policy and rule 1210 and all that's contained for a first reading.
Well stated. Seconded. Any discussion? Mr. Kunick.
Yeah, no, I strike that.
Beg your pardon?
Strike it. I was going to have a question, but it's kind of strays off the topic, and I don't want to do that. I'm trying to behave.
First of all, I just want to thank you for the staff for going through a lot of these policies, and the ones that are not necessary or redundant, I'm glad to see them eliminated because it saves a tree now and then on printing costs, but thank you so much. All in favor? Oh, go ahead.
I could comment and say thank you for many of the same reasons and just really bringing things up to date with, I mean, there's been tremendous changes since 2006 in technology alone. So I appreciate that as well. And it does streamline things for us too. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Do we vote on that? We didn't, should we? Sure. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Policy 2710, line staff relations. Dr. Sue.
Thank you, Mr. President and members of the board. We have another policy this evening, again, that is older policy. And in this one, because we noticed that organizational charts frequently change, they just do by the nature of the business. So we're recommending that basically this one is an elimination of 2710, line and staff relations. Organizational chart as a first read, and again, coming back to the second read. The charts will always be available, though, through District Leadership Council. We'll keep that in the office, my office of superintendent, and made available within 48 hours upon anybody's request. That's not a problem. Just policies, as you know, we just don't, it gets outdated sitting on the website or in a book.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation, policy 2710.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Donnie. Discussion of education for employment plan. Dr. Sue.
Yes, thank you. This one is, as you can see up in the front, the purpose of this plan really is to prepare elementary and secondary pupils for employment, and that relationship and alignment between our business and industry. And so districts are required to have a plan in place. Without going through the whole thing, we have a team up here in case there's additional questions, but there's guidelines. It talks about what the plan shall include. And kudos to the team members, Cheryl Colthy, Ed Kupka, Julie Hausman, probably several others that had sat in numerous hours and meetings to help update and revise the plan as presented this evening. So again, they are here if you have questions about the plan, but we are recommending that the school board approve our plan, our education plan for employment as required by Wisconsin PI 26.03.
Thank you, Dr. Sue.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation on the education for employment plan.
Been moved and seconded. Mr. Battle.
Just a comment and looking at the ACP leadership team, I'd just say to the extent we're able to include more private sector reps, it looked like there was, you know, 12 or 13 people on that committee and maybe a handful from the business community. Anytime when we're putting a committee together like that and there's the opportunity to bring in more people from the private sector that might be able to bring some value from that side of the table, I think we should encourage that. But generally, yeah. I think this is a good step and just want to make that comment.
Thank you, Mr. Battle. Any other questions? Ms. Stevens?
Not so much questions, but comments. And I think it's, as Todd mentioned, I think it's always good to bring people from the business world in too. And just the communication factor, some of the things that you've done this year that's really helped with some of our mentors that are in the schools that want to be supportive and have these conversations with our students. So anytime you can share that type of information with us, it's really helpful because we know many of our children don't have someone at home talking to them about these educational opportunities, and it really helps them to bond over something and really have somebody there that can kind of guide them through processes. So appreciate all that.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. And thank you all for your hard work. And where can I get a jacket like that for Gary?
I was going to say, that is a dang snazzy jacket. Thank you for taking the words out of my mouth.
Discussion action, request to submit the transition readiness grant to the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction.
Thank you. We have several grants coming forward this evening. And again, kudos to the team that continue to apply for grants to help support these additional opportunities for our students. So I know Ms. Jenny Schmitz up here as well as Julie Hausman, but this one is really helps us identify and create competitive work opportunities for students with special needs and that may not have those opportunities. And so this grant, if and when received, is $31,393. So we're asking board approval to apply for the grant and if received, implement the funds toward good use.
Thank you.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation for this grant award. Hopefully we get it.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Are there any questions? None? Oh, Mr. Duncan. Comment? That'll work too.
So since I'm an employee of Freighter South, I'm going to be abstaining from the recommendation to affirm this transition readiness grant to the Wisconsin Department of Instruction. Basically, I desire no real or perceived conflict of interest. However, I'm going to use the 3 minutes allotted and speak to the significant merit of this grant and my excitement for it. I included in my platform this past spring and why electors should vote for Duncan for KUSD. That was a reference to vote for Duncan was a vote of investment for the future, and that's why I'm proud to serve on the board. I used each letter of the word to describe what that investment would be, and this grant truly begins that journey. It is innovating for success. It is vocational growth for more youth apprenticeship programs. it is going to be in an environment for learning, preparing students for the future. It did take some time to gather the right leadership from KUSD, Gateway Technical College, and Frederick South to listen to each other, to think outside of the box, and to come up with an idea that could achieve funding. And it presents a new design to meet a focus on providing all students with access to resources, opportunities, and support to ensure that they can maximize their abilities and potential. I really enjoyed assisting in the grant development process, but it truly was the leadership of Jenny Schmidt and her team of Patty Barrett, Jenny Krause, Sue Johnson, and Catherine Barnhart, along with Julie Capelli and Vicki Hallbeck from Gateway Technical College and our Vice President of Human Resources, Nick Galich, who has been so instrumental in working with our community schools and Gateway already on school to work initiatives that brought this grant to this stage, and now our opportunity to affirm it and begin the work of generating brighter student futures. Thanks, Jenny.
Thank you. That was very nice. Thank you for the background, too. Very nice.
Thank you very much, Ms. Stevens.
I too would like to say thank you, and this is really exciting, seeing all these different partners come together and offering these different opportunities to our students. It's truly exciting. It's truly a need in our community, and thank you to everyone that participated in getting this accomplished. It's exciting, and I keep telling people about all the cool things that y'all are doing here, so appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stevens. Anything else? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Thank you all very much. Moving on, request to submit Wisconsin Fast Forward Advanced Manufacturing Technical Education Equipment Grant to the Wisconsin Department of Workforce Development.
Yes, long titles, but a very rewarding pieces of the things that we can receive. And this one is definitely needed. As the board, you did approve a 4.0 manufacturing course that we're going to be tackling this fall. And with that also comes equipment. So again, kudos to Teaching and Learning, Cheryl Colthy, Julie Hausman, and others. I'm sure that we're behind the scenes writing grants furiously to obtain the funds. So thank you to you all. But we are asking your permission again to submit, and if awarded, the $50,000 to implement the grant and spend the money for the equipment in order to carry out the course. So we're looking for approval this evening.
Motion to approve.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any comments? Mrs. Stevens?
Again, another great opportunity for our district. I'm so happy to see this coming forward.
Thank you. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Discussion action on Head Start Federal Grant Cost of Living Adjustment, or COLA, request.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the board. This one, again, is another grant. It's kind of a supplemental grant to help offset that cost of living funds. Annually, it's always provided to us. So again, we're just recommending that you approve that the money is to be dedicated toward that anticipated increases in health and dental costs for those employees under the Head Start, for the Head Start staff for the 2018-2019 school year. And we have Luann Rohde, our director of our early education Head Start program, and Ms. Valeri, our chief of school leadership.
Motion to approve.
I'll make a motion to approve the authorization, the Head Start federal grant cost of living adjustment request.
Seconded by Mr. Garcia. Any comments? Mr. Garcia, I know you're our liaison.
Thank you. As I read all the reports on that, such a great job you're doing, especially when, you know, you're applying for grants and all that. And, you know, I want to thank you very much, not only you, but your staff and everybody else that's involved being part of this process. Thank you.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved, and thank you very much. Authorization of 2018-19 expenditures prior to formal adoption of budget. Dr. Sue.
Well, I don't think this is a grant so much. Maybe it is, huh, Tark? But it is kind of interesting because despite the fact that our fiscal year begins in July, but as you know, our official final budget doesn't come till October, so somehow we managed to work through that. There's two recommendations that you pay attention to this evening. The first one, we recommend that the board authorize the payment of all currently authorized salaries and benefits beginning July 1 so we can continue in operation until the budget is formally adopted. And the second one is we also recommend that the board authorize expenditures in other areas to continue at the discretion of the administration. Those expenditures should not exceed 34% of the funding authorized in the prior year's budget unless specific action has occurred by the board. So Mr. Hamden is here if you have any questions, but again, this is an annual thing that we come for approval so we can continue working and earning.
Motion to approve the authorization for expenditures prior to formal adoption of the budget. And the, did I miss the second one? It's not on my. Excuse me. And I would like to make a motion that the board authorize expenditures in other areas to continue at the discretion of the administration. Expenditures should not exceed 34% of the funding authorized on the prior year's budget unless specific board action has occurred to modify specific programs or activities. Thank you.
Thank you. Second. Moved and seconded. Any questions? Comments? Thank you, Tarek. What more can I say? I really don't know how you do it year in and year out, but and still maintain your sanity. Or do you? I don't know. But thank you anyways.
It's more salmon.
You had a full head of hair before you started? Never mind. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Donations to the district. Mr. Kunick, do you have it?
I do.
Okay.
That's why I didn't have the second. The district has received the following donations. Disney Worldwide Services Incorporated donated $25,000 to the Bradford High School Theater Arts Program. The donation is to be used for the Nebraska Thespian Festival. Ocean Spray Cranberries donated $2,000 to the Lakeview Technology Academy Super Mileage Vehicle Club. Seymour and Associates donated $500 to the Bradford High School Greek Dinner. Kurt and Lacey Pearl donated $250 to the Fine Arts Department. The donation is to be used for costs associated with students' solo and ensemble fees. Lily Cross donated $70 to Stoker Elementary School, and Isla Goyette donated an additional $70 to Stoker. Those donations will be used toward a sponsorship of a tree. Forester Tree Service, finally, donated $90 to Stoker Elementary School, and that donation will also be used toward a sponsorship of a tree. So to correct that, I think they are sponsoring three separate trees, perhaps, or all three of them for one tree. Either way, I think it's a wonderful donation. Thank you to all of our parents and organizations out there who give so generously to help our students. And so with that, I would like to make a recommendation that our administration accepts these donations. And
I would like to second that.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Other business by law. And take a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 No nays? Okay, we are adjourned. Thank you very much.
Sue, you got a minute? I want to ask you.